The Strapped In Auto Racing Show on BCTV is supported by Shirley and Shelley Miller. Good evening. Welcome to the June edition of Strapped In. I'm your host, Mike Feltenberger. And tonight we're going to be talking about auto racing paintings, the history of the Reading Fairgrounds cars and some cars in the area by the paintings of local artist Forrest LeRoy. Thank you for being here, Forrest. First off, we'd like to go through some results and some upcoming events. Down at the Georgetown Speedway, the modified winner was Rick Laubach. Over at Lincoln Speedway, Freddie Raymer took the 410 Sprint Car main. At Selins Grove, Freddie Raymer made a double for the weekend, winning at Selins Grove in the 410 Sprint Cars. Big Diamond opener, Jarrett Umbenhauer won the small block modifies, with Brad Brightbill taking the sportsman events. Up at Port Royal for their Port Royal opener, Anthony Macri won. He drove 967 miles overnight to get to Port Royal, and he captured a victory at the Port Royal Speedway. The Outlaw Enduro Series ran down at Grandview on Sunday afternoon. The Blast in the Past winners were Andy Castle and Bill Gerhardt. Upcoming events, Wednesday, June 17th, Wingless Wednesdays start their season at the Shellhammer Dirt Track right off of Route 61 up past Leesport. They will be running their Wingless Wednesdays starting tomorrow night into October. Also, their Saturday night heat events with the go-karts and the slingshots will be starting. They started on Saturday. They will be going on Saturday nights also into October. Saturday, June the 20th, the Bruce Rogers Moneymaker event will be held for the Grandview Speedway opener. That's June 20th, Bruce Rogers Moneymaker event. Linda's Speedway, Friday, June the 19th, the Outlaw Enduro Series, along with slingshots and 600 modifieds. For you small car fans, Hamlin Speedway will be running their micros and slingshots every Saturday until the middle of September. And Mahoning Valley Speedway, they had their opener in front of a packed house and a great field of cars on Saturday night. Mahoning Valley Speedway, now under the direction of Keith Hoffman, will be hosting asphalt modifieds and late models every Saturday until October. Our guest here is Forrest LeRoy, local artist. We're going to hold up paintings during the course of the show. My first question, though, Forrest, is what was your first interest, drawing or racing?
Oh, drawing. I was pretty young when I started it. The fact we, all of us kids in the house, could always be found sitting around the table with a pile of paper and pencils drawing all the time. I guess my mom had us at it, but I'm glad she did. We all became artists.
Did you remember your first race, and when was it?
The first race that I saw was a 50-lapper. It was the last flathead race in 1962, and it was won by Gary Wolford in the 199.
And then you became a fan from there?
There was no getting over it after that.
Okay, we're going to be looking at some of your paintings. I got some other questions. How do you decide on what cars you're going to paint?
Oh, well, I think of the big names that were there and the nice cars. And the trouble is I want to do every one of them, but there isn't always that much time to do it. But I work out, I do two, three, four of them over. I mean, drivers with different cars that they had and that sort of thing. And the other ones, I keep about 15 of them going all the time because I get bored if I'm working on the same one too much. So in actuality, there's about, I'd say, 2 to 3 hours to take to complete one, but I do it in piecemeal. I jump back and forth to the other one so I don't get bored.
Okay, now this is a question that I hope you can answer. Are some cars and colors more difficult to paint than others?
I'll tell you what's difficult. Painting these cars with the black wrought iron, you know, the bumpers and the side rails, it's hard because it's usually in a shadow. And I have to make it
stick out.
You have to be able to see it while it's in the shadow. And I have to go over it a couple of times sometimes, like, till I get it right. It's not always that easy.
Okay. What is the average time to do a painting, Forrest?
It's about 2 to 3 hours. But it's done over a long period of time.
Okay, now, do you start out with the pencil drawing and fill it in, or do you go right to the colors, the paints right away?
No, I draw it. I have to draw it in. And some of the old pictures I got out of your Strapped In magazines, and some of my own. You had some good pictures in there, and my own. And the scenes I usually concoct myself. You know, I want to put them in a setting that feels warm, like it did on a, you know, on a summer night. And that's usually what people see, remember when they see the paintings. They like the feel of them. And I try to work that out more so than all the details on the car. Okay. I want the whole scene there, the night and the way we felt and everything.
Okay, for the rest of this program, we're going to show some of Forrest's artwork, and we're going to ask other questions while we're showing it. I'm going to show the first one up. For all you race fans that know, this is Buzzy Rudiman. Buzzy drove the 00, the Rudiman Chevrolet, the go first class car to 00 out at the Reading Fairgrounds. Was a very good feature racer and a good winner out there. He came up from Zephyr Hills, Florida, spent his summers in the Reading area, and decided to race at the Reading Fairgrounds and also some other speedways in the area. What made you decide on doing a Buzzy picture for us? Was it the car, or was it actually you became a favorite of his?
Well, I really liked him because his cars were always beautiful and neat. You could see the man had artistic talent.
Right.
Everything was balanced just perfect. And I even made models of them. But I liked him. He was popular. He had that kind of charisma that appealed to you. And he always had those neat cars, and he ran good. He was always in the front. So, sure, I rooted for him. He was great.
You know, the thing about it was there was a lot of race drivers that were fan-friendly, you know?
Yeah.
And when before the race, they'd sign autographs. After the races, you'd go in the pits when the races, after the races were over, and they'd sign autographs, pose for pictures, even let you sit in your car, in their car.
Yeah.
And I think that's sort of what's missing in local racing right now these days. The drivers are starting to distance themselves from the fans, and we really don't need that. You want to hold one of yours up?
Maybe that's from coronavirus.
Okay, what do we have here? That's Al Tasnati and Piscopo 39.
Right, that would be in about 1965 when he took the car over. I don't know what year that is, but it's between 65 and 68. And he was so popular out there, and his cars were always so neat. I always do some of him because he was a real charmer. He really had the people following him, and even if I didn't like him, I'd be doing the cars because he was just such a. He's like a movie star driving a race car. You know, he was that popular.
Okay, how do you choose your backgrounds, Forrest?
Well, that's what I do to make them so you know they're really mine, because I want the background to be filled in so that you can feel it. Whereas most artists will just draw the car and all the nuts and bolts, and they don't work much on the background. But this makes it feel like it's sitting on the track at night. You can feel the temperature in the air. I understand colors and things like that, so I know how to put that to work for me. And I thought if I'm gonna do this, I'm gonna do it right. And I have such fun doing these things. I'm not kidding you. I was doing it earlier today, and I thought, don't tell me I'm gonna miss this event now because I'm sitting here painting, And painting is something that just takes it. It takes all the negativity out of you, and you just feel like you're in a, you're in fantasy world or
you're
something.
You're bringing memories back, is what you're doing.
Yeah, yeah. Not only that, but it's the act of creation that's right. Really important, and that's what you're doing, and that's what makes you feel good when you're doing this, and it all adds up and comes together, and it's a profound feeling. It really is. And I have just as much fun doing these race cars as all my other canvases.
Okay. I'm up here. You have a painting of the first modified winner at the Reading Fairgrounds, Bobby Malzahn and Nick Cope's number one. You were following racing back then with Malzahn with the first winner. How do you decide on angles of some of these? By what you visualize or a picture you see, how do you get the angles on them then, Forrest?
Well, some I create on my own, but usually it's from pictures. I have to have pictures because they do different things. The cars twist when they go through the corners, and you have to see how the rails are twisted around, how they might be pointing this way and the other one's that way, and I have to see that. I don't need it all the time, but I have to have that stuff for reference.
Okay. Your turn to hold one up. What do we got?
And Bobby Malzahn, it was really interesting. He won the first race out there, modified race, and then the second one was won by Frankie Schneider in car number two. Isn't that something?
He's probably listed as the greatest driver of the last 50 years, I believe he was. And he got his way around a lot of speedways.
Yeah.
He always had a version that was the red and white number two, Frankie Sausage Bar Special, it was noted sometime. Now, if you're taking it off a black and white picture, Forrest, okay, mm-hmm. you make a color out of it, how do you translate the colors from what you're seeing in a black and white to a color picture?
Well, I saw the cars, and I have real good sensitivity for color. That's a real specialty of mine. Not all artists have it, but it really helps. And as you can see, most of these cars from that time were in black and white, so I had to do the color on my own. So even this Chamberlain, and these are all in black and white.
We'll get to that one. Yeah. We'll talk about that.
Yeah, but Frankie Schneider, I think he won 100 races 2 years. Through the year, he won 100. The guy was just phenomenal. I mean, Richard Petty, everybody knows him. Yeah. They all know him. Yeah. They sent flowers to his funeral and everything. Everybody in racing knows him. I didn't realize he was that big, but wow, he really was.
Okay, now looking at that, after what you were talking about with the side rails and the bumpers, you sort of lighten the bumpers up and put like a gray tint on the inside of the black.
That's the color he had on.
Yeah.
It was like a silver paint he had on. And so what I do, if the bumper is black and it's in a shadow, I just try to put a gray highlight on it. So you know the bumper's there. I'm not painting the whole thing. It's just a highlight. So your mind puts the rest in.
Okay. Okay, I'm coming up. You said this was your favorite race car driver, Rags Carter?
Rags Carter, yeah. I saw him beat Al Tasnady 2 weeks in a row. It was, a July race. June or July, he won 3 out of 4 races in 66, I believe. And he beat Taz 2 weeks in a row. And I remember he was the hot car that night, and Taz was coming through the pack, and he was following Rags up through.
Yeah.
And the two of them broke out front. And there was like a tow hitch, was right to the flag. I couldn't believe they were that close. But Rags has been around a long time, and Al couldn't get him out of the way.
Okay, now on this picture that I have here, this is actually a picture of the Cope number one coach. Mm. Is it easier or tougher to do a coach body than it is a coupe body for us?
Oh, I love to do the... It's hard, it's easier to do the coaches because, it's a more bigger and flatter plane. It's not, this has a roof on it. And if you don't put the roof exactly right, you're not going to get it. You know, they'll know something's wrong with it. So these are harder to do with the roof. But
okay.
I love to do the coaches because I like the coaches. There's really something about them that were fascinating, wasn't it?
Okay, what you got next?
Okay, this is in 1963 when Al Tasnady was leading a race. Frankie Schneider had wrecked his car a couple weeks before, and he came out with a brand new coupe, and he painted it black and put a number 50 on it. And I'll never forget the race. I couldn't believe it. Taz was way out front, and all of a sudden, Frankie came from behind. I remember when he broke out into second. I was sitting in the fourth corner. Till they went around one time, Frankie had a half a track on him already. I couldn't believe it. And they did say later that Al did say the car was hot, which isn't hard to understand.
Right.
It was overheated. But he really chewed him up. He wasn't afraid to pass Tasnady, I'll tell you that.
Okay, you have the 707 of Tasnady there.
Mm-hmm.
How do you like painting fenders?
I like them. It adds more to the car. See, this is the feel since we started. The cars look like this.
Right.
And we'll never forget that because the cars were different. Cars today, when I was a kid, we'd ride down a highway in my parents' car, I'd name everyone. They'd fly by me, and I knew what they were and the years and everything, and I was just a little kid. Today, I don't know any of them.
Yeah.
They're European cars, and they all look the same to me. I don't even like them. But these really had, they had character to them. The cars had character, the designing. And these, when they cut them down like that, they looked rugged.
Yeah.
And that's what I like, that rugged, masculine look. And that little pony tire, I was mystified by that, and the big tire. I first saw that in the flathead. So, whoa, what does that mean? It was really something. But this car, Deasy, the builder of that 707, he was a wizard.
Yeah.
I mean, he built that. It was so unusual, and it was like a sacred beast, a sacred monster. It could beat any car there anytime it wanted, if it was running right. And it'll never be forgotten. I started with him. I started making pictures of the 707 6 or 7 years ago. And I thought, that's the car I remember the most, and I'm going to do all the pictures I can of it, because it was so unusual. And he had a lot of winners in it, but he didn't have too many steady drivers. They didn't get along with him too well.
No, I know.
But the car was still amazing. And can I talk about that for a second?
Yeah.
The thing that I remember the most, that I love the most about the first year I was in to see the modifieds, I was, 12 years old? And Frankie Schneider and Taz were the hot ones. The New Jersey boys were up. Taz Schneider, Olsen, and McLaughlin. They were the hot shoes then for 3 years. And what I liked was when they would take the parade laps before the race. And I will never, ever forget this. And I've talked to other people that remember it too. Taz was ever the showman, and him and Schneider were always in the back. And when they would come by, he would back off, and the flames would shoot out of that thing and envelop the whole back end of the car as he was taxiing by. I couldn't believe that he could do that. I thought it was going to blow up, you know. Look at them. The whole thing was enveloped with it, and people would go crazy, and then they'd go around and come around again. And as they came around the second time, he'd boom, 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 and you'd feel it in your stomach, and I heard you can hear it all over Berks County. That thing was so loud. And then people just went nuts. You know, Taz was a showman. He really did more with the car in that regard than any other driver. And I'll never forget that car. I just couldn't.
I remember a time, I think Warren did an interview with him and asked why he put his name on the window underneath the driver window, and he says because he wants the kids to see it. You know, if you're smaller, you look straight out, you can see it. If it's up on the roof and you can't see it. So
you mean who said that?
Taz Natty.
Oh, yeah. Okay, he didn't have his name on this one, did he?
I don't know.
No, he just had Wolf's on the top.
Yeah, that was Medizzi car.
Yeah.
When he was in the 44, a lot of times when he was in the 39, had Taz Natty right below the driver window.
He loved the kids. There's no doubt about that.
Okay, with that then. Do you, and there's a lot of cars from the Flathead era that many people remember, the Bobby Abel blue and orange number 2, the Bobby Gearhart pink and white number 2, the 1080, the Mushroom Specials, and the DeSantis cars. Do you ever try painting a Flathead Forest?
Yeah, but not like this. I do want to do them. I'm trying to get some more good pictures of them. People are just starting to put them on the internet now. Where I can, I save them all. I save everything you put on, I save, because I use them for references to do these things. And I love to do those. Remember Gerhardt's pink and white number 2?
Yep.
He was fast. Yeah. Boy, how many did he win? Do you remember?
I don't remember. I think, Russ Smith was the leading Flathead winner, if I remember.
Yeah, 23.
Yeah. And I was a Bobby Abel fan, because when I first started going,
So was I.
My grandmother and my mom took me. I was like 2.5 years old, June of 58. And I still remember this. It's amazing. I'm 64 now, but I still remember what happened. And that was the easiest name to remember, you know, Abel. Yeah. That was, so, you know, there I am growing up and I'm starting to talk and they're taking me to races so when I got to about 5 or 6 years old, I'm going, he became my favorite driver because he was easy to remember and it was a great looking car.
Yeah. Yeah, did he own that? The blue and orange too?
No.
I didn't think so.
Nope.
It was one of the forums down in Lancaster, I think.
Okay, I got a picture here I'm going to be showing. It is the 2A, Carl Van Horn, the 00. It's either Freddie Adam or Mark Weaver. I think it's probably Freddie. The 2A went through many stages. It was a coupe. It was a Vega. And they always had the injector stacks hanging out the top, the hood of the car with the big hood over top of it. Do you enjoy doing your action pictures, racing cars against cars?
Oh, you bet. In fact, I want to put more of them in, but I've been wanting to keep the whole car on one page like this. But there are some that I have extra space, like that one. And it's good to fill it in with another car cocked and coming through the corner like that, because that is what's so interesting about these things, where they slide through that corner with the wheels cocked. It's just unbelievable. I was in love with it from the first time I ever saw it, and I don't even want to see. Why would I want to see anything else? I mean,
it's amazing. Funny for us, because these days a lot of people are used to seeing these freight train races. You know, you got one car in the front and a line of 16 behind them. When you went to the Reading Fairgrounds, very rarely, if you went through the field, were they all stretched out and there wasn't a 2-wide or a 3-wide somewhere in the pack.
Yeah, even when Taz and Schneider were winning big, you never knew who was going to win.
Right.
They did. They passed and weaved, and people would stand up and scream. You know, it was much more to it. And even the modifieds today, I've been to a couple of races at Grandview, and what's the other one up in... I found that's more the case now. They are follow the leader. They're following the whoever starts in a pole usually wins there. It's just they're like the sprint cars.
Sprint cars have been coming like that. Yeah.
What is doing that? Is it what's causing that phenomenon?
I don't know, but Grandview. I get down to Grandview, and they still put on a fantastic show down there with 2, 3, sometimes 4 wide that stretch in it. But when they run the Wingless Wednesdays out at Schellheimer Dirt Track, there's very rarely is it. I mean, it's an 1/8-mile high bank track, and very rarely do the cars get stretched out. It's always tight packs and some good 2-3 wide racing.
I know up at Big Diamond, I liked it up there. But I know for a while Brightville wouldn't go up, and they asked him why, and he said, well, you know, I get tired of rebuilding my car every week. He said it's a lot of work, you know. So he just wouldn't go there anymore.
What you got next?
This is Bobby Gerhart, and he's the one who broke he's one of our locals, I guess the first local. No, Tobias was the first one to stop the New Jersey domination in 65. And then Gerhart came in and took over that ATCO 54, and he won 11 features his first year. Wasn't that 69,
yeah.
I think? 69, he dominated for till 70, and then Chamberlain took over. Yeah. It was all Pennsylvania drivers. It came from the Bugs, and they took over. And I was happy to see that, because I loved the New Jersey drivers, because they were really showmen. They were doing it a long time. You can see that, you know. And our guys were a lot more yokely, like, you know, yokel types. But I was really happy when Toby and Gerhart and them came in and started winning big.
Well, the thing about it was Gerhart took Toby's place in the 54. So they kept it Lebanon. It was a Reading based car, but they kept it Lebanon based as a driver.
Yeah, and the same team, ATCO.
Yeah, Atco. They were based over in Glenside.
He won 3, 4, 5 championships in a row with that, didn't he?
So you got the Flames coming out of that one. What possessed you to put the Flames on the side of the 54 then for us?
Because it makes it look exciting. I mean, we know they're there when they back off in the corner. Right. It's not when they're on the gas; they're going fast, but it's not as exciting on a picture.
Now you have injectors on that 54,
yeah.
Right? Well, all of a sudden, years later, then Bobby Gerhart became Mr. Carb.
Yeah, he won like that too.
Yes.
Yeah. Yep. He won a few good races with that blue number 5, didn't he? That was carbureted.
Yeah. Okay, with your numbers and your lettering. Okay, you're very precise in your numbers and your lettering.
Mm-hmm.
Is that something that you can pick up right away from a picture, or is that something that you have based in your memory on what it looked like while I was on the speedway?
No, I look at the pictures for that. But I will tell you this, not too many people can do that. They can't do it as thinly as I do, and really, not that I'm comparing myself, but I'm just making an observation. That's another forte of mine, to really letter things small. I did models like that, and I put them on from time to time. I think you might have seen a couple. And boy, people used to ask me, did you letter that with a toothbrush? a toothpick.
Toothpick.
It's like I was painting with a toothpick. No, that was a regular full brush. I just take the corner of it, you know, I don't know, I was born with this art talent, and I will tell you this, that no matter where I went, it's the one talent that never failed me. When I was broke, it always made me money. I never starved with it, and I did really well with it. In Europe, I was widely accepted over there, and boy, they're the real artists. We don't really have art here in America. It's not big like it is there.
Okay, let me ask you this. We still, even at my age, I race slot cars over at Heister's. I race slot cars up at Tim's up in, Randy's up in Kutztown. But we still have a faithful contingent of alley racers in the area. They race at Steve Keller's house. They race at Antietam. There's a couple different places that... Were you an alley racer in your time?
Yeah. When I was a kid, I used to paint everybody's cars. They would come up on a Saturday afternoon, and they'd be standing there in a line waiting for me to finish them. I didn't charge them. You know, it was just... So we don't... I wanted everybody to have a nice-looking car, so it would be more realistic for us. But we'd love racing in the alleys and different. It was like going to different tracks. If you go to a different alley, there were different. You had to beat them. You know, you were invading. It was really a lot of fun. I mean, that fairground track, it turned Reading into a circus. I mean, it was fun growing up there with that track. Yeah. Everything in the fairs we had in the summer, and the weather was always nice. I mean, I didn't realize that till later how really great it was growing up in Reading with that fairgrounds track, and the families were all in on it. Yeah. All in. Everybody in the house had their own favorite, and they would talk about it all the time.
Yeah.
And I just loved it. I even got my mom. She started going out. She saw Bud Olson. She said, "Oh, he's a good looking man."
Well, we had it. My wife Mina. We were going to be married 45. We're going to be married 45 years this year.
Wow.
And they used to have season tickets out there. And yeah. I'll tell you what, when I first met her and we were going together and everything, we were talking about the races. Well, if this wasn't her father was a Dick Tobias fan. Her mother was a Jackie Evans fan. Mm-hmm. She was a Freddie Adam fan. And I was a Gerald Chamberlain fan. So boy, if something led to a, you know, accident or wins or whatever, there was plenty to talk about while we were
or argue about
discussing racing.
Yeah. Yeah,
I mean, I had the upper hand though when Gerald was hot in, you know, 71 and 72. So
I used to go out with the Collar Boys. I'm still in touch with them, and there's three of them, and they all had different. Mark liked Toby, Craig liked Freddie Adam, and I forget who Gary's favorite was. It's funny, I can't remember. I think he was like me. He was kind of moving around, you know, always selecting someone new.
I think what was nice, though, was all of a sudden we were starting to get new drivers. You know, we got Kenny Weld came in, Gary
yeah.
Golub came
yeah.
in, you know, Bobby Allen came in, and these guys, Kevin Collins, and they sort of got to the point where the regulars had to work their butts off if they were going to stay at the top of the heap. Jimmy Horton came in and started running
yeah.
really good. So,
yeah. I really liked Kenny Weld. He was kind of an unusual person, and... Even Kenny Brightbill talks about how bright he was. He was really brilliant, a great engineer, I guess, and a bit of genius there. But I know when he came up here, I had heard about him years ago, how good he was, and he didn't disappoint, because the first night I saw him out there in that yellow 91, he came from behind and beat Tobias. Brightbill. In fact, I think it was a twin race. He beat him in both of them.
Yeah. Okay, I'm going to hold the picture up. The... Sock Valeriano Mushroom Special 6 Junior, driven by many drivers. There was many different versions of this car. You decided to do a coach version of this car. Was this one of your favorite cars to paint, Forrest?
It turned out that way. It wasn't all that easy to paint, but it was fun to do. And when I put that on, I got more feedback for that than all the other cars. I don't know. Everybody liked that picture. And oh my God, people from Canada were writing about it. You know, I had no idea these things were going all over the country like that. But that one was probably my most popular one that ever went on.
Okay, now with the picture being shown and everything, you really go into detail with the driver, hands on the wheel or cocked in the cockpit or shake or whatever with the helmets. And
mm-hmm.
What makes you go into such a detail for actually showcasing the driver?
I get them that you really think it's that person, too.
Right.
And for me, I have to do that. It's a must. I want people to know that it's him driving the car. And I'm a real good portrait artist, so this comes very easy for me, and I really want it to look like the driver. You see the Brightbill with his arm up, you know,
we'll show that one.
With the wheel.
Yeah.
You can see how the drivers are sitting and where their arms are.
You know, the funny thing about it was they always said Kenny was Mr. Outsider and Gerald would take the bottom. But if you could look at a lot of pictures as that, Gerald took the top
yeah.
a lot of times when he was racing against Kenny. And Gerald also started with an open face mask, a helmet, and then he went to the full face. And it's just amazing how you capture the driver's in the cockpit. What made you decide to do a, actually you can say the two most feature wins, drivers of the most feature wins at the Reading Fairground?
That's why I chose that. Exactly. Because they were the two big winners.
Hold that one up over there. There we go.
Yeah, they were the two big winners. And I thought Chamberlain would have been the big winner until Brightfield got cranked up there and just went past him and won 135, and he was still going,
yeah,
you know, when they closed up. But wasn't Dave Kelly the hot shoe in the last year?
Last year, yeah.
He won a lot. You're right. A lot of new faces were coming in, and if they got a good setup, you know, they'll win with it. These are all really professional drivers. And I really, really want to make the people know that's that driver in that. That looks like Frankie Schneider, and that does. I got the helmets and everything, and right, the way they had their glasses on, everything. It just comes second nature to me. You know, I want to be that way.
Okay.
I know.
Mike Beck's picture. The H&J 14, driven by Russ Delp, I believe, is probably at the time.
Yeah.
And Russ had a lot of good seasons at the Reading Fairgrounds. I guess one of the flathead runners that went into the modifieds. Okay, now that is not an easy color to pick out for that 14. It's like an off brown. How do you match colors? Do you tune or mix?
I'm a colorist, and you can get a lot of colors today that will pretty well match up with it. But almost every one I have to match. A tough one to do is the McLaughlin and Olsen cars that were cream colored.
Yeah.
And if you don't get that cream color right, it will look red or brown. You must get it right. I've taken it off many times, you know, and done it over. Because I know when it's right. And I don't want them to say, that's not the color. And they will.
Okay, say on this picture, Forrest, of the H&J 14.
I love that car.
What happens if you start and you don't like? Can you actually erase it, or is there something you could put on it to take off what you don't like, or how's that work?
Yeah. Well, this is a water-based paint, so all I do is take water and a brush and go over it, you know, and loosen it up and wipe it off. It's not oil, and it's not permanent. So after it dries, it is, but I mean, it's water-based, so I can. I've corrected a lot of them. A lot of these are old paintings that I've brought back and refurbated them because they were sitting around, they weren't right, and I wanted to get the colors back up to par. And I had a lot of fun bringing them back. The color is natural to me. As an artist, I have a good sense for color and things. Okay. So I make it work for me.
Okay, I'm not an artist by any means. I'll stay behind the camera before I paint. But I do watch that Bob Ross every now and then.
He's a character.
The way he mixes colors, is that sort of how you do it with these, Forrest?
Yeah. I work at a table for these because they're watercolor. The oil colors I set up on an easel and I either stand or sit. Right. But the watercolors are, you know, these dry quicker. That's why I'm using them, because oils don't dry that fast. But I can get the results. If they're not right, I can change it right away, and it'll dry right away if I make a change. But it's water that I loosen it up with a brush and then wipe it off. Sometimes if some of the colors really go in the paper deep, so I gotta work like crazy to get them off.
Okay.
If I don't get them right. So I endeavor to do it right the first time.
Now, there was an artist in the area, Clark Angstadt, very good, Clark Art. But he was more of the abstract. He would give the general, you know, impressions on cars, where you go into a lot more detail.
Mm.
Does that make things a little bit more difficult? Could you actually do like a Clark Art thing and make things a little bit more abstract, or do you like making the detail so the driver or the people and the people seeing it actually can tell who it was and basically what the car was?
These people have these cars etched in their mind like
right.
I do, and you're not going to fool them on that stuff.
Right.
So I make it so they understand it, and they say, yes, that's it. I don't have anybody telling me that it doesn't look right. And I think the best trick I have going is, like you said, the drivers, because it looks just like them sitting in there, and they sense that right away. And you just couldn't believe the comments and commentary I get on these things.
Well, I think the big thing about the Reading Fairgrounds is, and a lot of the viewers will attest to that, you'd sit in a grandstand and you would know whose car it was going across the track just by the shape of the car.
Yeah, yeah. And and when they would, in a new year, if they would come out with another design on a body,
right,
and it wasn't painted yet, you can still see who built it because you knew his style of building. Right. And we knew it that good. You know, that we knew the kind of rails they put on them and how they were bent. And it was fun to look at things like that and see how they changed and still be able to identify them.
What you got to show this time?
Well, here's a Toby when he took over with from the 54 with his blue 17.
The Super Dog.
Yeah, the Super Dog. And boy, he won a lot of races with that car.
Well, he tore it up the first week of the 1 year. I guess he flipped in
I was there in the fourth corner. Jeez, boy, did he flip.
Okay, now we're going to go back to this. What makes you choose what color the wheels are, Forrest?
Because that's the color they were.
Yeah. So you go everything detailed to what you're looking at.
Sure. You know, I like them that way. Yeah. I mean, these guys really had good artistic sense. That one thing, the reason I liked the car so much, when I first saw them, even the flatheads, the first thing, they're so loud, you think they're monsters coming down when you're little.
Right.
But they looked like they had faces on the front. They looked like monsters with faces coming at you. And a little fender there. And when I got to look at them close, I was just amazed by the paint. The paint was always nice, and the lettering was always good. Even if it was a little sloppy, it was balanced. And the cars looked good. It was art, all rolled into building and painting. And okay, that's what I liked about it.
I'm glad you're saying that, because now it's at a point where everything's basically digitally done. You run it through a big, you know, printer.
Yeah.
It's a wrap. You've just wrapped what you did around the bodies of the race car. Back then, everything was hand-painted. Mm-hmm. Do you, in a way, feel that the hand-painted cars brought more justice to the cars back then than the so-called, you know, graphics that's coming out right now?
Well, these were works of art.
Yes.
When they did them with their hand. I lettered a couple of them myself. And boy, was that fun to do. But today, people ask me to make them. They're like rolling billboards, a big square sign with all kinds of fancy letters. And those letters are all made in computers.
Yep.
And I can't imitate that with a brush.
Right.
I could, but it'd be very hard, and it wouldn't be worth it to me. It's just not as challenging to do a car like that, and I don't even like them. I like the colors. I really like to look at them. And still, they have different angles on the cars when they build them. I look at all that stuff, but it's not like the old ones were. It was the cars that were so fascinating for us because they had so much character.
Okay, now there, Tobias had a weird color blue, but you actually also have him in his blue driving suit. Is that something that you want to bring the realistic part of the painting to the fans seeing it?
Yes, sir, because I do have a couple of pictures of him I took off social with him standing there wearing his blue uniform next to the car. And I had to get that in for sure. This painting was very popular. This Tasnati, I had him coming through the first corner. That one really went over big. People told me they could smell the gas fumes coming out of it when they looked at it. And that's very popular. I had a lot of people ask me to make them copies of that.
Okay, on that one. Keep that one up.
Oh, okay.
You did talk about the black for the frame rails and black for the chassis. That was red all the way around.
Yeah.
Does that make things a lot easier for you to do?
Yeah. Yeah, because even though the red might be in a shadow, I can put a darker red on. I don't have to erase it like I would with just highlight it if it was black. But I put a carmine or crimson color. Crimson is darker red.
Okay.
And you can see that. That's part's in the shadow. And then I'll put a flame red where it's right, where the light's right on it. So you can see the difference on the rail. Yeah.
Okay, my next one is I have a version of Toby before the Gerhardt one when he was driving the AT Consoli 54 with the red numbers. And that car was sort of plain compared to the Gerhardt one with the lettering on the side and everything.
That car that you're holding there, that's another one that brought me huge feedback. Everybody liked it. Well, a lot of people liked Toby, but the car, it came out really well.
Right.
It's sitting, it's angled just right, and they pick up on that, whether they're artists or not, they pick up on that. And that thing was very popular for me.
Okay, now looking at this picture.
He had black rails too.
Yeah. Now, you're very precise with the hoods. Is that a touchy thing for you too? Is to make that hood look as realistic on that race car as it was supposed to be?
When you're doing these old cars and they're all built by different people, they're all different, and you have to be sensitive to that different. And if, like, again, if you don't get it right, it's not going to look like it. The hoods have to look like it. The roof has to be shaped like it, and the cuts they make in the door, it has to be just like it. I've made them that it wasn't. I'd have to do them over because it wasn't right like that, and they'll notice that. I'm painting for the people to help. I want to bring their memories back. That's one reason I'm doing this. And I'll tell you how I started it 2 years ago on June 1st. My girlfriend passed away. From an infected heart valve. And I'm an all-nighter. So I was, zonked out from that. But that night, I decided to break out of that, that morbidity. And I just started playing with these. And I put a few on the internet to see how they, just for fun.
Right.
Not to sell them or anything, just for fun. And I put about 5 or 10 of them on. And I was up almost every day and night for the next 5, 6, 7 days. That's how much feedback I got from those things. So,
well, I saw you posted one of Frankie Schneider a couple months ago. And they're probably, I don't know if the guy, but it was the most likes any post on that page had in about 2 or 3 years. And it was, like one of your Frankie Schneider pictures. And it's amazing that you're bringing back memories of race fans from,
His daughter loved that. Jeez, oh, she loved that car. She the whole family, they just loved it. And I thought I had it on before, but maybe they never saw it.
Now, what track was that based on?
I don't know. I think Harmony, maybe.
Yeah.
No, okay, this is Frankie. I think the picture come from a Harmony picture, but I tried to make it at Reading, in the first corner. And There's things that can identify these tracks that people will know that whether it's Reading or Nazareth or not, from the fences and the colors in the background.
Okay.
I heighten the green because it adds to the picture. The fences were lighter than that.
Okay, find a Chamberlain picture for me, please.
Here's this one.
Okay, here we go. That's different. This is Gerald on the inside.
Yep.
Now, Gerald took notice of your stuff on Facebook. And you contacted each other to the point where Gerald wanted some of your artwork.
Yeah.
And I talked to Gerald recently, and even you had trouble getting a hold of him, but he says it is the best hand art that he has ever seen, and he appreciates everything you do for racing. And Joanne almost came to tears the fact that she said it was so nice. Now,
wow.
Talking to somebody, you talked to him on the phone, does he seem, a lot of people, their race car drivers aren't human. He actually does seem like a personable human being when you talk to him.
We must have talked for 2 hours. and he was right there with me, He told me a lot. See, you can learn from somebody like that. That's why I think you should tape him, because we have Freddie Adam tapes and Frankie. Because they share a lot of memories that will be long forgotten once they're gone. And I asked him about Flemington and the drivers and the track, because a lot of drivers didn't like that track. And he told me how he used to have breakfast with Tasnati every morning there. And he said he was really a friendly, personable guy. He said he learned a lot from talking to him, too.
Yeah.
And he said that. But he also found out another thing when they would go to a club or a bar or something, how popular Taz was and how unpopular he was compared to him. He was that big, you know. He had to make a point of that for some reason.
Okay, I got the next one here.
He likes the 707, though.
Yes.
I don't know why.
But DZ lived right near him.
Yeah, I didn't think he cared for that car. I loved him. When he was in the 707, I thought, boy, now we got a big... He won 4 in a row at Reading.
Yeah.
And I thought, boy, that's some team, But and I thought he always... I talked to him one time at the fairgrounds, and I thought he liked the 76. He didn't seem to want to talk about the 707 at all now. But when I talked to him, he wants the pictures of the 707. He didn't even care about the 76.
Yeah.
I don't know why that... Why I'm probably from hearing from other people how much they like the car.
Yeah. Because they didn't do... The 77 was a simple yellow body 707, and then Chamberlain scrolled up on the top. That was it.
I know.
Yeah. Okay, I got one of the... racing favorites at the Reading Fairgrounds here, Jackie Evans. That was my mother-in-law's favorite driver. Passed away too soon on a front stretch accident August 28, 1970. And there's another one, though. How can you match that maroon, and you have the great flames coming out of the side of it, but how do you get the picture of that maroon that you can hit it dead on with the color then, Forrest?
Actually, it's not a maroon like you would see in the daytime. I have to set the color to those bright lights that hit it at night, because I like the night pictures better.
Right.
They're warmer. And I just play with it till I get it, but it doesn't come out of the tube like that. I have to make that one, the maroon. I've tried to different paints from the tubes, and it just didn't add up. But I had to make my own. But he's fun to do. 70. He was such a colorful. It's amazing how the guys that were really colorful and personable, you like doing their cards more. It's just something that, you know, it envelops the whole team, you know, the friendliness and...
Okay, even the one that I'm holding, the Jack Evans, you even got it as precise as they did not, they put the number, the roof number at the corner of the roof. Mm. Is that something you picked out right away?
Oh, yeah, sure. Yeah, they had different, I did different versions of that. They changed the paint from time to time. And what were we just talking about?
The
77. Yeah, I have a number, I have five or six Evans, and I have a couple more. The blue 77, he won with that first. Well, do you know about this? The owner of that car, Lutz? Aren't they from...
Lux.
Yeah, Lux. Yeah, what did I say? Lutz. Yeah. Yeah, Lux. Johnny Lux?
Johnny Lux.
Yeah, he just came out of nowhere, but I did find out... I saw old pictures of Gerhardt driving the Bug. That was his.
Yeah.
It was in Brown 77. Yeah. So as soon as he came to Reading, he picked up Evans, and he was winning right away.
Yeah.
He was very popular.
What you got in your hand for the next one?
This is a comparison between the 44 coach of Tasnati. Who's the owner of the 44?
Cozy.
The Cozy brother Cozy coach. And that red 666.
And the Ritter Klein top 666.
Right. That is a beautiful. That's one car that they always kept neat.
I loved every one of their cars.
The coupes.
The coupe, the Mustang. The Falcon.
Yeah, even they look good, the late body.
The late bodies.
They look good, too. They always had a beautiful, shining car.
Okay, we're down to 10 minutes. We'll go to one of mine, because you were just talking about this earlier, Forrest. Jackie McLaughlin in the 83.
Mm.
Okay. He is another one that went away way too soon. You got him sliding off the turn, but as I can attest just by looking at it, you got the cream color the way it was supposed to be. And I can see what you're saying. Because if you would have went too dark, it would have got like tan. And if you would have went too light, it's more like white.
That happens at times, but I won't release it that way. I'll play with it until I get it right, for sure. And boy, that was another amazing car. You should see the ones that I have three or four I'm working on now. Before the 83, right before this one, the one he was killed in. And... boy, are they fun to do, and they are really beautiful. I can't wait to get them finished. They're just a brush stroke away, and I couldn't finish them up for this, though.
Okay, we're down under 10 minutes. What you got showing us this time, Forrest?
That blue number 7, I always liked that Eddie Pratt one with that car. Who was the owner of that?
Herb Vail.
Herb Vail, yeah. Yeah, I'm just a little tongue-tied today. But I always liked that because that's my number 7, my birthday, and my favorite color is always blue. So I liked it for that reason. And he's another one that beat Tasnati.
Yeah.
With that coach. Not many could do it. Not many.
Okay, we're going to go to another local favorite that was the Kennedy number 98 with Beater Kennedy. I don't know why I'm holding all these drivers that recently got killed on the speedway. I mean, it's not something I really, but another fantastic. Their 98 was, every time you saw the car, it was different.
Yeah.
What made you decide to pick on this one with the slanted numbers instead of the big bold numbers that were straight up and down?
Well, this is the one that he was starting to get high finishes in. He had a couple of seconds out of it. And I love the color turquoise. That's why I did that one.
And you also got him sliding. And
I think the first modified I ever saw, they used to come by my house on Perkiomen Avenue. And he'd be on a trailer coming in from Birdsboro, going out to the fairgrounds, and it was purple, and he had that back end cut off.
Yeah.
And that's another thing that mystified me, when they would cut the back end off like that. But it was purple, and at that time, purple was really my favorite color, with white 98s and a blue, light blue stripe around them, and I loved all their cars.
Okay, we're heading down here. I got a couple questions, and we're going, we got Taz Natty in the...
The Cope, yeah.
The Cozy Coupe.
Cozy Coupe, yeah.
Now, I'm going to say this. You have the hood, the slanted down of the hood and everything, the injectors and everything. Do you visualize this as you're painting it, or must you keep looking at a picture to keep your thoughts alive on what you're doing?
Well, only if I need to, because I've been doing this a long time, okay. And I can basically do it blindfolded now, right. You know, to the point of even inventing what I want to. But I like to keep them pretty much as they are, so the fans really like them, and it brings back real memories. I had two of these 44 here, though.
Oh, okay.
The front ends are a little different.
Yeah, the hoods are different.
Yeah.
And the rear of the bodies are different.
Yeah. Did you see the race when he won his last in that 260?
Yeah.
That was his last race. And remember, he beat Jerry in that.
Yeah.
And they were neck and neck through the whole feature. And I'll be darned.
You do like putting those flames out the side of it. I got to give you that.
Yeah. it's more exciting.
Yeah. You know, the Perry Andre 260.
Yeah. Yeah, one of the guys, I put it on one of his sites. And he liked it so much, he took it and put it at the top of the page, right at the first week. He liked that 260 that much.
Okay, we did a 707. I can move that one to this. Okay, let's go to Carl Van Horn in the 71E. He probably was one of the unluckiest drivers at the fairgrounds. He'd be leading for, 25 out of 30 laps or 30 out of 35 laps, and all of a sudden the next lap he had a flat tire or was involved in an accident, not his choice or anything, or he headed the pits with engine woes. He always had fantastic cars, nice and plain and simple. But what made you decide to put a Carl Van Horn 71E together?
Well, I found out, I didn't know Carl Van Horn. And he came along when I was away, but I did see him race a lot in that 71E. I saw him win a race with a coach, and I saw him, I liked him in the 2A. I met the man whose father built that 2A, the Vega.
Walt Garrett.
The Vega. No, Walt Garrett was the owner, but the Smith built the car. And so I learned a lot about it from him, and it fascinated me. And I saw it. That was the only car I ever saw that I thought was as fast as a 707. But they were both Fords, and they both dropped out all the time. I don't know why. Gus Freer had that 76 cooking all the time. It was a look out
of.
We're
down to 5 minutes. What do we got here?
Jackie Evans. I got a whole bunch of them here, Jackie. See, they're different versions of them. The numbers are different, and the pipes and everything.
Now you even get the door posts at the right angles.
Yeah, that's important.
Do you actually measure it out from a picture, or how do you actually get the angles of the door posts and everything precise for us?
I have to look that picture over several times to make sure it's right, because once I put the number in, I can tell if the post isn't lined up right.
Okay.
Because I can see that the whole door is off.
Okay.
There's your Buzzy and Jackie.
Okay, so show that one, we're down to less than 5 minutes, so we could probably make this the last picture. You got two Florida guys that came north every springtime to race, Buzzy Rudiman and Jackie Evans, and Buzzy's still racing.
I know, he's 80. He's 80.
Yeah, he's doing very well.
Yeah, I know. He's not aging hard.
No, now you have the track colors. Do you use them, do you make them the same color on all of them, or do you sort of like lighten them up to emphasize the color of the car? How do you work with the track colors?
The track colors change just like the sky changes. Sometimes they're wet and they're darker.
Okay.
Other times, if they water them down, they're muddier, and the consistency and the color changes. So I'm very careful. I don't want to make them all the same.
Right.
I want to make each track fit the car that I'm doing in the time. So a lot of these are black and white, but I know enough about the track from walking on it and looking at it and studying it all the time. And that the track, to me, when I started doing these, was the most important part, because it wasn't a dark, ugly track. It was red.
Right.
And that red showed up under those lights, and that's what makes the pictures look warm. That's why I work hard on the track. I'll go over it several times until I get the track right.
Okay, we're down to 3 minutes. I have two questions.
Okay.
Do you enjoy painting the later model Redding bodies or the coupes and the coaches?
Coupes and coaches, all the way. They're fun. There's just so much more character to the cars.
Okay, and this other one you can... You said you painted a couple of the modifieds at the fairgrounds. Whose car did you paint?
Jerry Becker. I think I was 15 or 16 years old. I painted his 41A. It was green, and they didn't have anybody to paint it, and I was there. So he left me. Jerry got along. He took to me right away for some reason. We were always friends. He was about 12 years older than me, but he had that 41A sitting out there, and I painted it up, and I put a big Yogi Bear on the back. And then later, I painted that 41A when it was a late model car. It was white and orange, like with an orange panel, and I put yellow 41As on it. And he got me the job with Vince Pantuso. He came up with a brand new car. It wasn't painted. It was yellow, and he said he wanted red and black 20s on it, so I put it on and lettered it up for him. And they were by the third one, my talent was starting to show, you know. They were getting better.
Okay. So, yeah, I knew Speedy Lou. Speedy Lou's painted some race cars in his day, too. Okay, our last question to call this a show. Can race fans order and buy any of your work?
Soon. I'm not set up to copy them yet.
Okay.
But they will soon. I'm working on it right now.
Okay, so where can the people see your works of art? You post them on Facebook?
Yeah.
Is it your page or is there a racing? I know you have them. You put them on Strapped In magazine page.
Yeah.
And you put them on my Dirt Track and Pinto's Vegas and Valiant's pages.
That's just for later body, isn't it? Later body.
That's the
cars.
Later body ones.
Yeah, I try to keep the early ones off that page. Yeah, there's about 20 of them I put them on. They're all over the place. Okay. Everybody sees them. And I get answers. People write to me right from there. They see them and they can, you know, they send you a feedback, a comment. And that's how I'm making all my connections. And they're asking, some of the guys don't like one. I haven't sold any yet, but they don't want you to.
Yeah.
And I got yelled at already and I wasn't trying to do it, you know. But they asked me straight out, oh, please, you know, will you make this for me? So I take their names down, but I said, look, I'm not ready to do it yet.
Okay, but they can find Forrest LeRoy on Facebook.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
They won't miss my cars.
Okay, everybody, you saw a pretty much of the Reading Fairgrounds history through the paintings of Forrest LeRoy. Thank you, Forrest, for being here. Fantastic work. Like I said, you can see his stuff on Facebook, and he will be selling his stuff in the future, but not right now. So on behalf of Forrest LeRoy, I'm Mike Feltenberger. Thank you, and have a good evening.
The Strapped In Auto Racing Show on BCTV is supported by Shirley and Shelley Miller.